Today, it's an important game of the LQ. The Ottawa GGs would like to finish fourth. The Queens Golden Gales would very much like to finish first. And, Jamie, today's game should go a long way to deciding exactly who finishes where.
Well, it's going to be a very critical game for Queens. They want to win today because if they win today's game, they are going to be in first place.
Rick Melnick will kick it away for the Ottawa GGs. The Queens Golden Gales will begin. They will go left to right. You're looking at the Ottawa GGs right now. And again, it's a most important game for the GGs, who still have a shot at the McGill Redmen. And if you're thinking this one looks like a potential blowout, it might be. But Ottawa has beaten Queens once so far this year, 21-15. A short kickoff, not a particularly good one, and the Golden Gales will have pretty good field position. That's Paul Kozan, who will stay on and play in the backfield. And the Queens Golden Gales will begin from their 28-yard line as they continue to look for first place in the OQ. They're in a great battle with the Bishop Skaters and with the Concordia Stingers. Tim Pendergast, yes, he will start at quarterback. His statistics this season, impressive. He is a poised leader in his fourth year at Queens University. They've been building for his fourth year. They feel as though he could be the guy to lead them a long way. He is able to spread things out to all of his receivers, and they do have a ground game to go with it. Elberg in the backfield, and that's Brad Elberg with his first carry of the game. And Elberg picked up just a few, maybe three. It'll be second down and seven. Elberg is starting at tailback for the first time this year. Beresford, who led the OQ in rushing last year and leads the team in rushing right now, starts at slot back. That is one of the biggest changes for one particular game that we've seen all season.
It's an incredible change because he was the leading rusher in the OQIFC last year and an all-star in that position. And now to take a person of that caliber and stick him outside, it tells you something of the caliber of Brad Elberg.
Pendergast out of the backfield to Elberg, and Elberg one-on-one with the linebacker Steve Glenn had no trouble beating him. A gain of 16 on the first down for the Queens Golden Gales. Here's how they will line up offensively, a very big offensive line. Everybody is more than 270 except for Scott Gray. He's 234. Everybody else 270, 280, 290. In the backfield, Pendergast, you've already seen Elberg, one carry and one catch. Kozan, they like as well. The receivers, this might be the strength of the offense. Ed Kidd, a former quarterback at tight end, is having a terrific year. Out of the backfield they come. Kozan brought down very quickly. They didn't have the matchup they wanted that time. And Kozan's gain is just a couple. That was Chris Johnson on the tackle.
Well, it's incredible when you take a look at the Queens offense, the number of changes that they have instituted over the past couple of games. Even from last year, Ed Kidd, as you were mentioning, Michael, was a quarterback last year. They thought he had great potential to be the starting quarterback here. But too good of an athlete to have sitting on the bench when Pendergast was there, so they got him playing in the game at slot back.
Second down and long. Pendergast in the air on through a strike, and Pendergast has another first down. Dave St. Amour on the reception, but Pendergast looks sharp to start this game as he goes against this Ottawa GG's defense. Along the defensive line, it's Rebel, Brady, and Huber. And the linebackers are very active and pretty good in a fairly experienced secondary. Likely the best player, certainly potentially the most explosive player on the field right now, is Chris Banton, number 18, defensive back at the very top right corner of your screen. Terrific punt returner. We expect they'll stay away from his area. Here's Kozan, and Kozan picks his way through for a gain of six, maybe even seven. It'll be second down and fairly short. Gale's impressive to start.
Yeah, they are impressive right off the bat. I mean, they're mixing it up. They're trying to go outside. They're going left, right, inside as well. As we take a look at the Ottawa defensive front, the left end, Huber, nose tackle Brady, and the right end, Graybell.
The strength of this defense always seems to be linebackers. A young crew now. They've had big changes over the past year. And we'll tell you about the secondary in a second. Right now, it's the Golden Gales, second down and about 3.5 yards to go. The pitch to Elberg. And Elberg does a good job. Boy, he gets his shoulders turned upfield real quickly. And Elberg picked up eight, and Doug Hargraves has another first down, third straight. The secondary will line up like this. And again, the man at the top of your screen, Chris Banton, is the best of the secondary. We expect that they'll stay away from him. Chris Johnson, also experienced, but everybody else fairly young. They are inexperienced, and as Larry Ring said, this is a rebuilding. 27 of their 40 players, first or second year. And when you've got inexperience at quarterback and in the secondary, that usually means a struggling season. Well, they do go in front of Banton that time, and they get another reception, Dave St. Amour. So I thought maybe they'd stay away from Chris Banton, but two passes in front of him already.
Yeah, it's funny. They're going to the left side, too, and when you have a right-handed quarterback, usually you end up throwing more to your right side. Now, Pendergast, to set the situation now, he was injured in the very first series when they played Ottawa earlier this season, a game in which they lost 19-15. He had a sprained knee. He has been out since then. 10. This is his first start since that game.
Kozan, the fullback, the carry, and Kozan spun off one potential tackle, and I think he picked up the first down. So the Gales really sharp coming out. They've gone to the air three times, and Larry Ring right away under pressure.
Well, they're running option here. That's the thing that Queens will kill you with. I mean, we've seen them in the I formation. They're running pitch. We've seen them run play action pass out into the flat. Now we see a little bit of option. Multi-dimensional offense.
Golden Gales looking at first place in the OQ. A victory today could potentially salt that away, depending on action elsewhere. First and 10, 20-yard line for the Gales. Four straight first downs. Pendergast throws over the middle, and it is picked off. Yes, the receiver had a great chance at it. Beresford playing in slot back. He dropped it, and unfortunately for the Gales, tipped it up at the very end, and the GGs have the ball.
Well, it was a nice pass by Tim Pendergast. You're going left, and they're trying to throw it to Paul Beresford downfield, doing a little hook pattern inside. Now, you see number 41 just to your left of your screen, the linebacker, Eric Lehman. Now, he comes across and keeps his eye on the football and does a little juggling act and manages to squeeze it. It gets actually not a bad return, so a big break for the Ottawa GGs.
No apparent reason for the drop by Beresford. It was a soft pass right on the money. He missed it the first time, and then in desperation tipped it up, and as you say, Lehman right there. First and 10, GGs, 21-yard line. Boy, did they ever dodge a bullet. Very impressive. Queens drive ends right here. Swarming Queens defense limits the gain by Angelo Michelli to just a couple. It'll be second down and long for the Ottawa GGs. Here's the way they line up, and like the Queens Golden Gales, very big along the offensive line. Weisbach at 270 isn't even the biggest offensive lineman. They average about 270 pounds. In the backfield, freshman quarterback Steve Clark. They like his ability. He's still young, though. Joseph, likely their best runner, 6 feet, 210 pounds, also in first year. And Michelli, the receivers. Casagrande and Brett Wilson are the experienced couple. Grigg leads the OQ in pass receptions with 29 so far this season. So I think if you're talking about the strength of that Ottawa offense, it is the receivers as a injured Queens Golden Gales.
Jamie Lewin, outside linebacker. Now he would be a big loss for them, not only... It looks like he's all right coming off the field right now. He'll probably be back, but he's their leading sacker this year with four sacks, so they like to rush him on the quarterback.
You know, if you looked at him, you would say, is he a defensive back? Maybe a linebacker.
Yeah, he's only 5'10",
like a defensive line.
Right, he's only 5'10", 190 pounds, but he's a rush linebacker.
Steve Clark faced with second down and long. Clark has a pretty good throwing arm, and here he throws one actually at the feet of Brett Wilson. So it's incomplete, and exactly what Larry Ring didn't want has happened. They'll give the ball right back to the Queens Golden Gales. Well, I'm making reference to the Vanier Cup. Everyone wants a trip to the Sky Dome and a chance at the Vanier Cup, and I think if you poll people across the country, you would have to give the Gales a pretty good shot at making it to Toronto on November the 30th.
Yeah, this is a funny league. We said earlier, I mean, it's very difficult to predict. I mean, Bishops, they blow out McGill a couple of weeks back, and then they tie them last week. It's a difficult one to call this year.
John Hamilton's kick. Fairly low, a returnable kick.
There we go!
And the Gales get a decent return, and then a penalty. May have been a face mask. We'll find out when we return. The Gales have good field position, and depending on the call, it could get even better. We'll be right back.
Well, you can see the face mask there. Now, we can't make out the number because that player is wearing a jersey over his jersey to make him eligible in the line of scrimmage, number 49. We do not have a listing for that number, so I'm sure that he likes that because we can't actually pick him out of that highlight and blame him for causing the face mask and giving Queens excellent field position on the Ottawa 28-yard line.
Doesn't really matter who it was. The fact was that they did grab the face mask after a short kick and a decent return, added all up, and terrific field position for the Gales. Here's Elberg. Misdirection play, and boy, did Elberg ever turn on the Jets to turn the corner. You know, Hargrave said he's got 4.5 speed in the 40, and I wondered whether that was legitimate. It looked legitimate there.
And I'll tell you about that play, Michael. They're running counter backside. They're trying to bring the guard tackle from the backside to kick out. Now, you'll see in the right of your screen, you'll see the guard pull around. Now watch, Elberg's supposed to cut up inside of that, but he sees that I've got the speed outside. They don't have the contain. I can just put on the jets and get upfield. And you're right, he has 4.540. He benches 400 pounds. That tells you the kind of strength he has. Gained about 20 pounds from last year. Weighs 207 this year.
Gain 18 there down to the 10-yard line where they've got first down. Jovetic caught the ball at the 5 and ended up at the 9. And perhaps Ottawa should have let him go a little longer. He could have been back at the 10 or the 11. Gain of maybe 1 at second down and goal.
And you can see Pendergast just tell Jovetic as well, hey, when you catch the ball, don't work yourself back to me. You have to turn around and knife up field and get your shoulders going into the end zone.
And hopefully the ball, too.
That's right, because, I mean, if you gain 1 yard, I mean, Pendergast, yeah, I might as well just force sneak it at yard.
Pendergast, 9 yards have been impressed far early. I think Ottawa was offside. Pick throws, and he's got a touchdown. Shoestring catch by Barrett. Ottawa Gigi's, I believe we're offside in the Gales. Well, now Ottawa's pointing this way. Queens has already come off and put their conversion team on. I think you've got potentially two officials making different calls. Well, judging by that one Ottawa player's reaction. Well, the drama continues to build.
We have a procedure. Queens. No touchdowns, 5-yard penalty.
Sounded like something was coming after that. I thought he was going to say something against Ottawa. Left tackle.
Ball is on the 14-yard line.
The Ottawa player, that was the one that I saw move early.
Yeah, it looked like the Ottawa player was offside, but it's...
And the catch by Beresford. Look at the catch. I mean, that is a real tough catch for someone who hasn't played much. Early motion again. Pick it up, second down and goal. And Pendergast pass goes off the hands of Ed Kinn and then just past Jovetic, but that time... Well, I was sure the last time that Ottawa was offside, and maybe the replay confirmed it, but I think the Gigi's were offside definitely there.
Okay, offside, 72, red, down with Vita.
Well, so we're right back to where we were after the 1-yard reception by Jovetic. Second down, goal to go from the 9-yard line. Larry Ring got a break, and then his team turned it right back. Second down and goal. Pendergast throws, slapped away and picked off by the Gigi's. Wow, what a break. Coming in from behind the play was number 51, Luke Brady. He looked up and there was the ball.
Well, that's incredible. He's a happy guy. I mean, a nose tackle getting a break like that. Actually, I think it's Sean Clark.
It may have been 55 or 51, but watch where he is. He's in behind Pendergast now.
Now, there's great protection here, and that's a nice job. I think it was Richard Grable getting his hand up, knocking the ball forward. Actually, it was Wade Huber, number 77, who got his hand on it. And another big break for the Ottawa Gigi's.
Just like the first, they avoid a touchdown. Actually, they did give up a touchdown there, but the penalty called it back, and now they've got first down from the 17-yard line with the Gales defense right there. Angelo Michelli, second carry of the game, and like the first. Doug Hargraves likes the way his offense has moved the ball. He certainly hasn't liked the way they finished off the drives. Queens Golden Gales defense, an experienced defense along the defensive line. They have the ability to pressure the quarterback. As far as the linebackers are concerned, I think this is the strength. Boone, perhaps the best name in football for a linebacker, Peter Payne and Dan Palou. Screen pass for Michelli, race to the outside. Let's see if Michelli can get there first. No, he can. And the Gales hold again, and they'll get the ball back, predictably in very good field position. 6:57 to play in quarter number one. We're still scoreless.
Well, they're just trying to have full flow outside. They just get the back out Angelo Michelli and run him outside. But you can see the pursuit of the Queens Golden Gales. Look how many people are around the football. There's 5 yellow shirts around that football. You're gonna play, when you play great defense like that, you're going to win a lot of football.
I want to ask you a question. You saw Brett Wilson, the wide receiver there, trying to block the quarterback. On that play, should the wide receiver, the way the play designed, should he be way downfield to try to take the cornerback out of the play?
No, he should try and block him, actually. There's a stock block. He just missed the block outside.
Hamill kicks it away. This is a high kick right into a crowd, and the Gales have the ball at the 45-yard line, and the surprise of that play is we have no penalties down. 45-yard line is where the Gales will begin their third drive. They've been impressed. pass them on both, but we're still scoreless at Richardson Stadium. Ontario, Michael Landsberg along with Jamie Bone in a scoreless football game. They celebrate the 150th anniversary of Queen's University, where they've been playing football for more than 100 years. Queen's Golden Gaels have now had the ball three times. Their first two drives, very impressive, all kinds of first downs, but two interceptions, and I think you could say the first one clearly not the fault of Pendergast as Beresford dropped the ball. The second one knocked down by a lineman into the hands of a linebacker. Here's Elberg. And Elberg breaks the tackle and turns the corner, and an official way on the near side of the field, perhaps 30 or 40 yards away, throws the flag. I'm not sure why.
I'm not sure why either, unless it was holding or something in the backside, but I don't see how that had any effect in the play at all. And
I mean, he was way behind the play. Elberg picked up close to a first down.
Holding against Ottawa.
An unusual call, as I'm sure Larry Ring will probably question on a running play when the defense holds. But
27, red, hold, Ottawa holding.
Now that's the quarterback on the near side of your screen, which was way away from where this action is heading.
Well, they're just running pitch, and Kozan gets a nice block outside. But you can see the speed again. Look how he gets around that corner.
Boy,
that's impressive.
That was impressive because the corner didn't seem to be there, but he did get around it. First down, Queens Golden Gaels. 35-yard line. Kozan breaks a couple of tackles and now heads for the end zone. Kozan with a terrific block downfield. And finally, the Gaels get into the end zone, but Beresford gave him a great block at the goal line.
And also David St. Amour downfield. We were talking just a few minutes ago about stalking, a receiver going down and stalking the defensive back. He did a nice job. Another running option here. Just inside, and they run option track. You see they pull the left guard across, and everybody's going to the left, but he's coming back to the right, and a nice job by David St. Amour there, and another nice job downfield by Paul Beresford.
Beresford just did a good job to shade his man away, and the toughest part about this was staying on your feet for the celebrations afterwards. 35 yards on the ground for Paul Kozan, and finally the Gaels get in the end zone, and after 5 minutes and 46 seconds, they lead by a score of 7-0. And the Ottawa GGs better find some offense in a hurry because they are singing here at Richardson Stadium. Great anniversary celebrations taking place, and a great way to start the football game for the Gaels. They've got the lead. We'll be right back.
Here, one by David St. Amour on Chris Banton, and busted outside. Then another nice block downfield here on Luigi LaRosso by Paul Beresford, and we see Paul Kozan slide into the end zone. Looked like a guy sliding into second base.
Jamie Galloway kicks it away, and the Ottawa GGs have got to find some way to keep their defense off the field. Here's Chris Banton. Banton, explosive player to the outside. He can fly. Chris Banton. This won't keep the defense off the field, but who cares?
Incredible. Chris Banton, the CIAU Rookie of the Year back in 1989. Certainly did not look anywhere like a rookie there. Looks like a seasoned veteran. Looks like he's been doing this for a while. And when we first did a game with Ottawa in 1989, Chris Banton busted on the scene because of this. He was a great punt returner, a great kickoff returner. And look how he just accelerates through that hole.
Look at the hole open up, too.
And now it's a foot race. Galloway thinks he has a chance here. He realizes I've taken the wrong pursuit angle. Now it's a foot race.
Look at Jovetic. Had the angle on Banton all the way, but he couldn't close at all.
And then Dagnoni was the last guy that has a chance. No way. Chris Banton.
There's the point by Melnick. Is good, but there's a flag on the way.
Well, he might have been a little embarrassed in the block that David St. Amour threw on him when Paul Kozan scored. Well, he certainly answered that one with a long kickoff return.
Chris Bant, before the game, we referred to him as potentially the most explosive player in this game, and I don't think that even we anticipated that we'd see that kind of explosion. The Ottawa Gigi still without a first down. But they're happy that the defense will now drop back on the field because Banton took it all the way, and that's something that probably one of the few edges that you would have to give Ottawa over Queens.
Got a great hair. too. I like that. Chris Banton really...
I'm interested in the way you're saying that. You say you like that. It's a great haircut. Can we assume potentially next week?
Next week we'll have one. Yeah, I think so. I'm going to find out who his barber is. I'll have to get one done. Chris Banton, a preseason All-Canadian, a defensive back this season. Last year was plagued with a lot of injuries. Did not play a great deal last year. This year injury-free. And great to have him back in the lineup if you're Larry Ring. Now, I said earlier that Larry Ring was in his second year. Larry Ring is in his first year. I guess I just thought he was in his second year because he's so experienced, been around football in the OQIFC, was the assistant coach with McGill back in 87 and also with Concordia, and now the head coach in his first year at the University of Ottawa.
He got what he needed there. Now he has to find some way to stop the Queens Golden Gales offense. GG's down very quickly, and you can see a real spark in their play now that you clearly didn't see early on. They came out very flat in this game, but Chris Banton, one of the nicest kids that you could ever meet, gives them some life. He has a terrific smile, and he had every reason to smile there as Banton gets the Ottawa GG's back in the football game with 5:26 to play in the first quarter. This was looking like a game that would certainly be reflected by the weather for the Ottawa GGs. It's rainy and damp and not a great day, and it certainly started that way on the field for the GGs. Let's see if this sparks the defense. Elberg caught from the backside that time. Richard Rebel brought him down, and he's gained just a couple. Perhaps the best job that they've done on Elberg so far. Queens has got a lot of weapons, you know. Pendergast is a veteran cornerback who can really spread the ball around and keep the talented receivers and running backs happy.
Yeah, well, he's the guy that really kind of makes it all happen. They had Steve Othen play last week, who played very, very well. They're very pleased with him. But Tim Pendergast is the seasoned veteran on this Queens football team.
Pendergast to the air, throws into a crowd, but he's got a completion close to a first down. He needed to make it right to the 35-yard line. Might be an inch or two short, but good zip on the ball for Tim Pendergast, who makes his return after missing last week's game against the Carlton Ravens. Of course, Doug Hargrave said he could have played, but thought it was just a good move to sit him out.
And, you know, I believe that's Paul Beresford's first reception this year for the Queens Golden Gales.
Third down, and maybe it, well, you can see where the nose of the ball is. It's almost in the stripe, and he just has to make it about halfway through the stripe. So not much question whether they'll go for it. The Gales will. Beresford did have the earlier catch for a touchdown, called back because of a legal procedure. Pendergast on the ground, picks up the first down easily. Think of that change, though. If you think about other schools or other leagues where you take your leading rusher, a player who hasn't caught a football all year, and all of a sudden he shows up at slot back, and yet, certainly if this first 11 minutes is any indication, looks like a pretty good move because Elberg is explosive.
And Beresford's a very good athlete. He played quarterback at Fisher Park High School. He came here, played tailback. Now he's playing slot back, so he has the ability to play.
Elberg started inside, went outside, perhaps an illegal block. David St. Amour.
Yeah, you can see Chris Banton over there pleading his case. Doesn't matter. He threw
Elberg,
the flag.
Ball carrier, but there's a flag on the play.
It'll be holding against the Gales. So what was an 8-yard gain will now be
78, Queens holding, down repeated.
Yeah, actually it looked like a clip from up here, but we're going to take a look at it. You'll see number 78 at the top of your screen. Oh, I guess he's holding his arm, that's what he called, but it looked like a clip.
Banton still made a good play to come over and make the tackle.
Yeah.
But that's what Elberg can do for you. Forget the illegal block. Started inside, didn't see anything there, and he's got the speed to boot it outside. First and 20, Pendergast throws deep for Beresford, and he went up high, but well covered on the play. And it's incomplete. Stasiak was there.
Luigi LaRusso playing safety as well, number 35.
Just a series of problems for the Golden Gales. A couple of interceptions, one drop pass that led to the interception, a tip ball, and a couple of offsides. And it's now a 7-7 football game, but could certainly have been a lot more for the Gales. Second down and 20. Pendergast, big pressure throws and has a man. Jovetic made a diving attempt. Pendergast did a very nice job to simply get rid of it and get it
and avoid the sack, because I tell you, there were a lot of folks in on him right there. The pass protection didn't look very solid. Now you see it's tough here for the quarterback. He draws back that way, turns back inside. And I believe it was Steve Cook, number 45, inside, giving some pressure to Tim Pendergast.
Pendergast did a nice job, as you say, to get rid of it, but he also put it fairly close. But still, second down and 20 is not what Doug Hargraves wants, and it's now third and 20. First punt of the game for Jamie Galloway. Probably like to keep it away from Chris Banton, but he does not achieve that. Banton with the ball. One kick return for a touchdown already. And Chris Banton very close to springing another one. He's just got incredibly quick feet. And he's a player that has played a lot of his career on artificial turf. But here on the natural grass, he looks just as explosive.
Yeah, he's a great special teams player. There's a great block that it almost took actually Chris Banton out as well. But you can see the quick feet. Not very big, 5'6", 160 pounds. But his legs just churn all the time. He keeps them moving.
That first step by Banton was outstanding. That does come away limping a little bit. Gigi still without a first down, but they feel better about it since they're now tied at 7. And there's the first carry of the game for Darren Joseph, who has some quickness as well. He's an explosive player, first year.
Now, he's a first-year player, but he's actually in his third year at university at University of Ottawa. Played a few years with the Ottawa Sooners and attended the Ottawa Rough Riders training camp this past season. And Jim Daly, who's the running back coach with the Ottawa Rough Riders now, former head coach at the University of Ottawa, said he was very impressed with them, but he felt he just needed maybe one more year maybe of seasoning, and this is what he's going to get at the University of Ottawa this year.
Second down and 5, the GG's to the air right through the hands of number 26, Brett Wilson. Excuse me, was that 26 or 16? It was 16, Andrew Grigg.
Well, that's unusual for Andrew Grigg. He's the big receiver for the Ottawa GG's, and one of their offensive keys, we said today, leading receiver in the OQIFC, third in the CIU, 29 catches. Those are the kind that he has to squeeze.
I guess those are the kind everybody's got to squeeze. But for the GGs, without a first down, very flat offensively. They needed that. That's the bad news. The good news is that when Hamilton punts it away, they should have Queens pinned back deeper than they've been all game. Line of scrimmage is the 40-yard line. Hamilton. Oh, this is a beautiful kick up into the jet stream. And 1 yard deep in his end zone. Questionable whether he should have stayed in the end zone. And the return by Dave St. Amour is just a couple, so the Gales will start from inside their 3-yard line.
Now, you brought that up, a questionable call whether or not to bring that out. Now, he has to usually look to the sidelines before, get some indication from the coach to say, do I give up one if it's in the end zone or not? And he obviously did not have that kind of communication, but I agree. He should have given up the 1 point, bring the ball out to the 35-yard line, give Tim Pendergast a little bit more room to work with that offense.
The question now is, why are the Ottawa GGs even in this game? When we show you the stats, they'll be dominated by the Gales. And the answer is very simple. Specialty teams. One kick return for a touchdown, a terrific punt, and very good coverage. And the Gales, tied at 7, are inside their 3-yard
line. And I think you also have to add great linebacking play by Lehman and also Sean Clark.
Elberg hits the pile and then moves the pile. He's got speed, but he's also got pretty good size. Elberg at 200 pounds, combined speed and power, and that time simply muscled his way ahead for a gain of perhaps 3.5, close to 4, and it was second down, call it 6.
Brad Elberg out of Regina, Saskatchewan, and you wonder, how did the University of Saskatchewan not land Brad Elberg?
And his running back mate, Paul Kozan, from Regina, Saskatchewan. Yeah.
Sheldon second Williams
down.
High School.
Second down and 6 over the middle. Nice pass by Pendergast, and a fumble. The Gales get a real break. Boy, did they get a break. Ed Kidd made the catch. Pendergast threw it before he'd even broke it, but he then had the ball pop loose.
Ron Herman, number 55, playing offensive center today. 6'4", 275. Doesn't get his hands on the ball that often, but as a center he does today, but normally he plays guard. But a good heads-up play, but a nice hit in here by number 58, Steve Glenn.
Gales do get a break. Not only do they pick up the fumble, but they keep the first down. 20-yard line, Pendergast to the air. Elberg out of the backfield. And again, that's the matchup that they wanted. Steve Glenn one-on-one with Elberg.
And Steve Glenn, he is the leading tackler in the OQIFC with 56. So he gets a lot of work. Good linebacker, 6'3", 230. And he's got quite a job today because he's going to have to cover Brad Elber, a player with 4-5 speed out of the backfield.
Perhaps Ottawa will have to consider making an adjustment with Elberg and his speed. That might not be a matchup that they can win. Then it'll be up to Pendergast to recognize it and throw to somebody else. Second down and one, and Pendergast easily picks up the first down, and that is it for the first quarter of play. A quarter dominated by the Queens Golden Gales. They roamed up and down this field. They had it all their way, but two interceptions, an offside penalty limited them to one touchdown. The Ottawa Gigis, it's one play. A kick return by Chris Benton for the score. We're tied at 7 after 1. Welcome back to Richardson Stadium. They've been pointing to this weekend for a long time. This weekend they are celebrating the 134-yard line. Their touchdown came on a run by Paul Kozan. The touchdown for the Gigis came on a 93-yard kick return by Chris Benton. We're tied at 7. And Kozan stopped immediately in his tracks. Richard Gravel, Steve Glenn, and Luke Brady are right there to bring him down very quickly.
Well, if you take a look at what Ottawa is doing on defense right now, they're just matching up straight across. They're just saying, hey, we're going to play man coverage in the secondary. We're going to start bringing some people, our linebackers, and we're going to force you to play. We're going to play smash-mouth football with you because they think they're going to have to hang in there and play tough.
What kind of football is that?
Smash-mouth, they call it.
Okay. Never heard that term before. Second down and call it still 10 for the Queens Golden Gales, and they haven't been faced with second and long very often today. Pendergast throws once, Jovetic, and has Jovetic. Threw it very nicely. Jovetic breaking back. Just got in front of Dave Wallace for the first down.
That was a nice route by Steven Jovetic at Oak Ridge Secondary School in London, Ontario. And a nice pass by Pendergast because, again, man covers. They're isolated at number 27, Dave Wallace. And he puts it outside so that Wallace has to try and come up and try and knock the ball away. Unable to do so. And Jovetic did a nice job of protecting the ball by keeping his body between the ball and the defensive back.
And that's not a big body, just 5'7". The other wide receiver, Dave St. Amour, who comes towards you at the bottom of the screen, only 5'5". Not much size outside. A lot bigger inside. Here's Beresford, the OQ All-Star running back. Now a slot back. Carried the ball, but without much success.
Well, Paul didn't look very comfortable running the slot back counter in that play. It looked like he wanted to get back almost into the halfback position or get into that I position to start running the football.
Now, you might think because he's a running back, he should be comfortable running it from anywhere, but everything really looks different.
Oh, it is different. Oh, sure. And actually, the movement is a lot different. His approach is different.
Second down and long. Pendergast throws, and he's got Jovetic over the middle again. Pendergast has been very sharp so far. Although to some extent his statistics won't back that up.
And this is a nice read by Pendergast as well, because you'll see just to the left there, your screen, number 41, Eric Lehman, was kind of playing in the middle, but he kind of went more inside, and then Pendergast threw it outside, so he's throwing opposite of that inside linebacker.
Third reception of the game for Tim Pendergast in the timeouts. We'll talk it over with the offensive staff of the Queens Golden Gales. Gales have kind of roamed up and down throughout the top 10 so far this season. St. Mary's Huskies, perhaps the biggest surprise, at least the way I classify it, 5-0, tied with the Western Mustangs for the best record, but they're number one right now. Queens Golden Gales, number 3, UBC Thunderbirds. Not as good as many of us thought they would be, but they're in a very tough conference at 3-2. Laurier Golden Hawks, after a loss last week to the Western Mustangs, 4-1. Then Manitoba, they are actually 4-2. The Manitoba Bisons, with their win last night, 48-11. Over the Alberta Golden Bears, improved to 4-2, and is that program back for what? Then it's Concordia, Bishop, Saskatchewan, and Waterloo. The defending Vanier Cup Saskatchewan Huskies don't look like they'll be back in defending.
Well, I think Manitoba are going to be in the Western Final. That's what it looks like right now.
First game of the season, we saw Manitoba, and they showed outstanding talent. Here's Elberg around the corner, and he got a couple of very nice blocks to spring him to the outside.
And you said it, Michael, Elberg around the corner. I tell you, did he ever get around the corner, because of guys like Ken Kirkwood and Jason Moeller blocking for him, and also Paul Kozan leading. You can see, double team in there, number 66, Kirkwood. Nice block by Kozan. And then Elberg gets to turn it upfield. I mean, that was the first person that was even close to him made the tackle. That's 10, 11 yards downfield.
Here's a drive that began from the 2.5-yard line. It's now at the 37-yard line of the Ottawa Gigis. Early motion, I think, by Ottawa. Throw over the middle, and Ed Kidd think his vision may have been disturbed on the play because Eric Lehman moved in front. Was it Ottawa offside again? It was.
Don, repeat it.
Ottawa simply too eager. They may have got away with one earlier when it was called procedure.
Yeah, they're very eager, Michael. They're trying to really heat it up and come after Pendergast.
Which is great. I'm sure Larry Rink's happy with their eagerness, but just have to be to wait until the ball snaps. Second down, first and five from inside the 35-yard line. They stay onside that time, and a pass almost directly between Beresford and David St. Amour. I'm not sure who he was throwing to.
See, I'm not so sure that playing man coverage with a quarterback of the caliber of Tim Pendergast is the right way to go, because they're trying to play man coverage in the secondary, bring a lot of heat. Now, for a younger quarterback, maybe he can get into his face and rattle him. This guy's been around for a while. He's in his fourth year, has been a starter for 3 years. He's seen it, and I think you're playing into his hands, and you're starting to bring a lot of people, and you isolate the wide receivers and inside receivers and man coverage. You can see they're all manned up inside here.
Second and five. Here's Elberg. Running low to the ground, he's short of the first down. Maybe a good 2 yards short, and now Hargraves will have to make the decision whether to put on Jamie Galloway or go for it. Let's see how close they are. They are a good 2 yards away, and Galloway will come on and try to give the Gales the lead. Doug Hargraves in his 16th year as head coach of the Queens Golden Gales. Mellowed over the years, I think.
No, I think Doug's always been mellow. I knew him back in 1974 when he was coaching at Dalhousie with Larry Haler. And he was very congenial then, and same kind of individual now, just a great man.
He is certainly a great guy for us to deal with. Friendly and accommodating and happy to talk about football and talk about what he's got planned.
And a pretty good record, 112 victories in his coaching career, 95 of those here at Queens.
I'll tell you, one of the things that I admire about our conversation with Doug Hargraves before the game was the running back position. I asked him, Coach, why is Beresford your leading rusher and an all-star starting at slot back? And he said, Elberg's a better runner, and I want to go with my best runner, whereas a lot of coaches would say they really wouldn't put it to you that definitively. They would hedge.
And they also get caught up in the politics of it as well,
right.
Not wanting to offend a player and that. But I think if you're straight with the players, I think everything usually works out okay. As long as you're straight with them, tell them straight up.
37-yarder by Galloway. It's tipped at the line, and Banton picks it up at the 5. And no yards against the Queens Golden Gales. And
I think that was Wade Huber again who got in and got a hand on that football. Number 77.
Well, they dodge another bullet. Hargraves' team is dominated, but still, we're tied.
Number 77, Wade Huber. You're going to see him come up and stick his hand up right here, right through the middle. And he gets a piece of that ball, and that stops him from going through. The ball did not make it to the end zone. Chris Batten picked it up, a no-yards penalty, and Ottawa get out of the shadow of their own goal line.
If Huber would have been back 5 yards where he lined up and he blocked it from there, I think you'd probably blame it on the kicker, but he got great penetration.
And that's two for him today. He had one down here earlier in the goal line. He blocked a pass of Tim Pendergast that Sean Clark ended up picking off. And now another one, two big blocks for Wade Huber.
GGs go to the shotgun formation. And they'll run out of the shotgun formation. Here's Steve Clark, and Clark has the GGs. Is that their first down in the game?
I think it might be. Sorry, that's their second first down.
I don't think he was ever thinking pass here, was he?
Well, it's man coverage. You can see number 33, Mike Boone. He runs right out of there trying to get onto a back, and then it all opens up for him. And then Steve Clark just decides to take off with it.
Shotgun worked very well. It opened up as Clark was patient enough to wait for the opening. First down for the Ottawa GGs. We're tied at 7. Here's Joseph. Starts very quickly. That's in the 2 carries that he's had, and his gains have been limited. Seems to have a good quick start.
Yeah, it looks like a very athletic running back, and I've heard great things about him from a lot of people in the Ottawa area. And Jim Daly in particular had high praise for him and said he could be one of the top running backs in the OQIFC. Right now he has an offensive line. It's tough, because even though their offensive line is a little bit older, when you have a new head coach come in, you put in a brand new system, it takes a while. Everybody is back almost to their first year again in terms of learning, and it takes a while to get together.
I'm just a bit surprised we haven't seen Joseph carry the ball more, but here he is, and he cuts back, and Joseph has a gain, and now Joseph defensive down to the 31-yard line. Yeah, I wondered why he hadn't carried the ball more, and now the question's even more relevant.
And that was all himself. What a nice cutback move here. They run pitch. They get outside. Dave Barban makes a block, and then he cuts it back inside in his great vision. And really does a nice job here of setting up the block and trying to deke out James Patterson, number 8. Who ends up actually making a pretty good tackle right there, one-handed.
Poor Patterson, though. I mean, Joseph was giving him moves all the way down the field. He dipped the shoulder once. I saw Patterson go back the other way. So Patterson did stay with it and prevent a touchdown.
He was out there all alone.
46 yards down to the 31-yard line. Collision on the exchange, and this play doesn't look like much, and it certainly isn't. First carry for a while for Angelo Michele. Made a couple of carries on the first drive. He lost 5, and there's also a penalty down. Is Queens offside? I think they were.
Hard to tell. Well, this is what happens here, is that both Michele and Steve Clark, one thinks they're taking the ball outside, the other one thinks he's handing it inside, and consequently, you get a collision like that, and the play doesn't go for much, but you were right, offside Queens, so it's going to be 1st down and 5.
Gales offside. Darren Joseph, 6 feet, 210 pounds. As you say, first year doesn't really tell the story, as he's an experienced running back with the Ottawa Sooners. He is a good-looking player. But he's out of the backfield. So does Michele. And they throw for Brett Wilson. Picked off. Chris McCormick. Two blockers out in front. Let's see if they can do the job. There's one block. McCormick stays in bounds with some fancy footwork. Chris McCormick all the way for the score. Good coverage by the GGs and a good downfield tackle. And the Gales will begin from their 47-yard line. Keith Kelly was a fine runner, a junior, went to Bishop's, had a good career there, and is now playing for the Toronto Argonauts. So while he's been hurt for the year, I understand Kelly will play this weekend. Okay. Trip to the Sky Dome for the Queens Golden Gales. Well, I guess the journey began a while ago, but this is certainly a key stop on the journey. They'd love to finish first in the OQ and have home field for the OQ final. Scoring drive, well, I guess drive might not sum it up very well. Chris McCormick, 85 yards on the interception return, and it's 14-7. Elberg. Lots of room for Elberg, and Elberg picked up close to 10. I think he's about the first down.
You can always tell those great backs, but it looks like everybody else is moving in slow motion while he's running it fast. And, I mean, Elberg is that kind of a back that makes it look that way. No, he gets outside and turns it up. He just keeps driving upfield. See a little bit of a tattoo logo on the side of a co-ed's cheek.
Not sure that she was a co-ed. I think she may have been a little young to attend the university now, but if she lives in Kingston, she'll probably end up here sometime. We've got young and old, 150 years of football being celebrated. This play never officially gets underway as the whistle goes in a legal procedure against the Gales. I was asking, we were talking about 150 years. How does that rank with the oldest institutions in
the
world?
Legal procedure, 62, who talk is banned, down repeated.
Wade Huber with a couple of key tips in this game.
That'd be a big loss for the GGs if he has to go out. Playing pretty well so far today.
We were talking about the oldest institutions, 150 years.
I know Acadia was founded in 1838, I believe, so they're an old institution as well. And
that'd be about 153, I guess. Fairly close. Really enjoyed our opening. We showed old footage of Queens and footage. I'm not sure where the original footage came from. We appreciate the help from the Queens Film Library. And that looks like the face of a linebacker, doesn't it?
Isn't it? Or a down lineman.
A little like Jack Lambert.
Yeah, but with teeth.
First down and 15 for the Gales after the illegal procedure. Jovetich is open, and Pendergast threw it perfectly. Just had one stride on Dave Wallace, but Pendergast threw a great pass.
Really is a great pass, Michael. I mean, this guy is just showing us something here today because he's mixing his passes up. Now, this is one where a lot of younger quarterbacks want to drill the ball in there, but he wants to give Jovetich a chance to catch it. So he throws it high outside and allows Jovetich to adjust to the ball away from the defender. I mean, that is just a heads-up play by Tim Pendergast.
Pendergast, as I said, didn't have a lot of room, but Jovetich simply had a step on Wallace, and the step was enough. First and 10, 30-yard line to the air for Pendergast. He throws, and it's underthrown, and dangerously at the feet of Banton, who broke back to the ball but slipped.
You can see the big rib pads that he's wearing around, covering his back and the side of his ribs.
One of the things to keep in mind for Queens, their two slot backs, Ed Kidd and Paul Beresford, both were quarterbacks in high school. Beresford has thrown one pass so far this season, a 57-yard touchdown pass. Kidd's also thrown a couple. Pendergast changes the play at the line of scrimmage. Just under 6 minutes to play in the second quarter, second and 10. Throws, and he's got a completion. David St. Amour down to the 15-yard line. And it's funny how you can just tell a veteran quarterback seems to be more sure of himself, seems to know exactly where he's going, and Pendergast has looked great so far.
Yeah, nice job both ways. And see, Pendergast comes out here in the semi-roll, and then he pulls up. They delivers a strike outside to David St. Amour. Now, Amour does a nice job here of making sure that his knee does not touch the ground. Goes ahead, make sure he has the first down.
14-7, Queens Golden Gales lead it. 5:25 to play in the second quarter. First and 10. Option, Pendergast keeps it this time. And inside the 10-yard line down to the 7. Perhaps the 8-yard line. The first time that we've seen him exercise that option where he kept the ball. Very well.
Nice job here, because Chris Lanth, the number 57, comes right in here. Or, excuse me, that's number 78, Richard Rebell. And he avoids him, and then he gets outside, realizing there's no pitch.
Very well-balanced offense for the Gales. Through the air, they've been successful, and on the ground, their problem has simply been finishing off drives. Two interceptions. They had a called back play because of an offside. It was a touchdown. Second down and a long three. Pendergast drops the snap, actually bobbles it, but has the presence of mind to simply fall forward and pick up the first down.
Well, there's no pressure push pull there, and of course they don't get the exchange.
Excuse me.
Pressure. Quarterback has to put pressure for the center. He has to push with the center, then he has to pull it back into his third hand or his navel or his gut or whatever you want to call it. And you have to have all three of those elements in order to take the snap from center. And it looked like one of the middle ones was missing. There was no push on that.
First down and goal to go from the 5-yard line. Queens looking to extend its 7-point lead. Pendergast to the end zone, and he's got a touchdown. Wide open. Paul Kozan with his second score of the game.
Well, when you run play action pass down at the goal line or sprint out pass at the goal line, everybody has to make sure they know who they have. And you can see both number 41 and 13, Chris Johnson is 13 and Eric Lehman, they turn around and start discussing it, who had him.
I guess the answer was nobody had him. And the Gales now lead it by a score of 20-7. Get a good look at the time remaining as well in the second quarter of play. Galloway's conversion, like the first two, good, and it's now a 14-point lead. Queens Golden Gales are eyeing first place in the OQ, and they look pretty good right now as they lead by 14, and they're singing in Kingston. Kind of an unusual football game. The Gales have had it all their way offensively, yet they've had trouble finishing off drives. But they did finish off this one, and they lead it by a score of 21-7. As Jamie Galloway will kick it away, and his big intention here is kick it away from Chris Banton. Banton with a 93-yard kick return. Now you see Galloway look out and try to spot Banton. He sees him top of your screen, so he kicks it, squibs it up the middle, and the GGs get it. They reacted very well to the attempted onside kick by Jamie Galloway, and the GGs, because of it, get very good field position.
I like the call by Doug Hargraves. It's an aggressive call at this point in the football game. They've taken the lead. Ottawa a little bit down. They're trying to put them away, and he just kind of squibs it just forward so that he can run ahead and try and get it.
Kicked it about 5 yards too far.
But a good heads-up play by number 72, Rob Hine, who's an offensive lineman, but we've also seen him playing in the defensive line this afternoon.
First down, Ottawa GGs. They go to Joseph. And Joseph picked up 5. It'll be second down and 5. I've known on that play, seemed to be heading right. It shifted fields very quickly.
Yeah, he's got great lateral movement, doesn't he? When he gets into the hole, he just kind of shifts left or right. No effort at all.
You know what he's also got? Very dirty arms.
I think he fell on the yellow on the inside of that Queens logo.
I think he's taken away a great part of the yellow. Second down and a short 5 to go for the Ottawa GGs. They really need a first down. 3:34 to play. Clark stops and now is stopped. Sacked in the backfield. Number 29, Jamie Lewin, who you made reference to as their best pass rusher for Doug Hargraves. The GGs will kick it away.
Well, the number 5 sack of the year for Jamie Lewin. Not very big in stature, 5'10", 190 out of Montreal Lower Canada College. Gets in there again. They like to bring their outside linebackers.
You know, I talked about the veteran Pendergast and how when he got back there, he seemed so sure of himself. I think by contrast, you could watch Clark on that play and didn't seem to be real sure of where he was going. Hamilton to kick it away. He's been busy today. And they fake it. Joseph. It's not Joseph. It's Angelo Michele, and they would have been better off with Joseph because the fake doesn't work, and the Gales have got the ball at the 40-yard line.
Now, this looks like the same play we saw St. Mary's execute last year against Western in the Atlantic. We're along the line of scrimmage, but didn't fool anybody on Queens.
It fooled one person.
You?
Yeah. I'm still not sure how the ball got in the hands of Michelli, but regardless, the Gales have the ball and a 14-point lead. Hellberg on the sprint to the outside, and he's won this race every time, and he wins it again. They have got to find a way to seal off the outside for Brad Hellberg.
Well, they're getting outside, and the people that have primary contain, the outside linebackers, are getting sealed inside. And then it's tough because it becomes a foot race now at the inside linebackers to try and get to the sidelines before Hellberg can get around the corner. And Hellberg, as you said, Michael, is winning that race time and time again.
Hellberg picked up eight. The last scoring drive for the Queens Golden Gales. Perfect balance on the ground through the air. Final five to Paul Kozan. And back to the action. Here's Kozan. And Kozan has been a very useful weapon for the Gales. He's got two touchdowns. And he's carried the ball effectively in the few times that he's had it. He's been their money man so far. Just his fifth carry of the game.
Now, if you're Beresford, you know, it's an interesting story because his role has really been changed. I mean, when he was the money guy a year ago, and now he's still contributing but not having as much impact on the offense in this game anyway.
Pendergast throws for Jovetic, and that one got away from Pendergast. Second down and 10 for the Gales with 2:22 to play in the first half. You know, Elbert's average coming into this game, 34 carries, averaging 10.6 yards a carry.
That's incredible.
Contrast that to Beresford, who was averaging 4.7 yards a carry.
And he had that big 200-yard game last week, Brad Elbert did against Carlton Ravens.
Second and 10. Here's Hellberg, and he's got to beat his man for the first down. Hellberg inside the 25, down to the 22 or so yard line. That's about where he had to make it to the first down. Because of the players on the bench, I can't tell you whether he's got it or not. Needed to make it to the 21 and a half.
And again, they get him outside in the flat, and the inside linebacker, Steve Glenn, has to come all the way across from the inside to cover him, and that's a tough job for the inside backer to do that, especially when you have a player of the speed of Brad Hellberg.
So Galloway will go for the field goal attempt. They'll spot it at the 29-yard line. It's already a 14-point lead with 2 minutes exactly to play in the first half. Now, the interesting thing would be if it's wide, because Banton is there. The fake. Penalty in behind the play and into the end zone. Incomplete. And actually, Banton made a very smart play to knock it down and not intercept it. The key here is, what's the penalty? It's going to be against the Queens Golden Gales, so the GGs will get the ball. Holding is the call. And Queens, rather Ottawa, will gladly refuse it. I saw a smile on Banton's face like, hey, of course I dropped that ball on purpose. But it was a very, very smart play.
No, it was a smart play, and Ottawa did a pretty good job of covering that because they had Dan McCullough downfield, the tight end, and he was going into the end zone. Everybody seemed to pick everybody up. That's why I was a little surprised that Pendergast didn't try and run it into the first down.
Actually, it was the backup quarterback.
I'm sorry,
Arthur.
Steve Arthur.
Clark throws, and he throws over the head of number 16, Andrew Gregg. Gregg yet to make his first catch of the game. Now he's the leading receiver in the OQ, so Queens has done a good job on Andrew Gregg with 1:42 to play.
Now, if you take a look at Andrew Gregg and his average per catch, 13.7, it gives you an indication that he's more of a possession-type receiver. He's not the kind of person that they're sending deep a lot, and we saw that last play, but primarily he's catching his passes around the 13-yard area.
Shotgun formation. They've actually run from the shotgun each time, but looks like Clark will throw, and he throws over the middle, incomplete. And a late penalty against the Queens Golden Gales. Late isn't the word. Half the guys were back in the huddle. And this should give the Ottawa GGs a first down. Well, there was an interesting reaction by the head official.
Okay, we have 7-0.
No, it was against the GGs.
We're going to apply the penalty. We roll it down.
And Simon Garner, who's the backup slot back who the pass was intended to after the pass fell incomplete. He threw down the defensive back that was covering him, and they threw the flag on him.
Just not much offense for the Ottawa Gigis. That was Garner.
Right here, and Simon Garner just throws him down after the play. That's just frustration there, I think, Michael.
Hamilton kicking from his end zone. Low kick. Fielded cleanly on the fly. That was a good play by number 78, Dave St. Amour. And the Gales have excellent field position. 1.5 minutes to play in the second quarter, and they've got the ball inside the 30-yard line. Actually, they're about a yard away from where they gave it up on the... Lots of time to play in the first half for them to operate. 1.5 minutes. Elberg and Kozan in the backfield. Here's Elberg on the toss. Big hole for Brad Elberg. He is obviously a talented runner, but pay tribute to the Queens offensive line that's doing a terrific job giving him room to operate. Still don't see a penalty marker on the field.
Number 78, holding, going to repeat the down.
Penalty goes against St. Amour, the wide receiver.
Holding the penalty against the Gales.
And we're going to see the hold right there on Chris Banton.
Did you see the hold there?
A little bit of one, but it didn't really have much of an effect on the play, and you can see a nice block there.
St. Amour's only 5'5", 155 pounds. He's holding one guy and blocking another, if nothing else. Give him credit for being ready, willing, and able. The pass almost intercepted. Actually, I should have prefaced that with almost caught, first of all, by McCullough, who dropped the ball, and then Banton, I think, was thinking about what he'd do with it after he made the interception.
Yeah, Chris Banton was looking end zone here all the way. I mean, that's how he thinks. Through the hands, and then Chris Banton right there looks like he was turning his head upfield to see, where am I going to run with this football? Didn't quite hang on to it.
So pull up the gloves a little higher.
That's it.
Second down and 20 for the Gales. 1:18 to play. Clock stopped on the incompletion. Bendegas throws, and he throws into double coverage. And now Banton, does he make the interception? No, he doesn't. Talked about all the correct decisions that Doug Hargrave's quarterback Pendergast had been making. That probably wasn't the best one there.
No, it probably wasn't his best decision of the day, but...
St. Amour was very well covered, top and bottom.
Yeah, good coverage by University of Ottawa. And Chris Banton, they were going after him a little bit earlier in this game, and they've continued to go after him, and they've really left Dave Wallace, the first-year player, all alone on the left side. They really haven't been giving him much work.
Timeout. Gales didn't seem to be sure whether they were punting or kicking a field goal. The last 45 seconds or so seemed to have taken a great deal of time. About 2 minutes left, Queens faked a kick before. Ottawa ran two plays. Now Queens runs a couple of plays, and they kick it back.
We take a look at Jamie Galloway prior to the game, another former kicker in the OUAA who's now here at Queens doing his Bachelor of Education. Andrew Astrom is coaching here at Queens University this year. And I think the Blues probably could have used his skills so far this year. He was one of the great ones in the OUAA.
They come after the block. Actually, Hargraves on the bench said that they would. They did, but they don't get to it. And the Gigis have the ball at the 18-yard line with 1:10 to play in the second quarter. Gigis are currently a point behind the McGill Redmen in the race for the final playoff spot in the LQ. The Queens Golden Gales are currently tied with Concordia at 4-1, a point ahead of the Bishops Gators. Big surprise last week when Bishops and McGill played to a tie.
Yeah, really big surprise, because when we saw Bishops and McGill play earlier this season, Bishops looked like a team that no one could ever stop. They had such a high-powered offense with Silvio Martel, who was right on, had close to 250 yards passing in the first quarter alone. And then to think last week they had to rally in that game to tie it against McGill.
Be that kind of year in the LQ. How do you explain Ottawa's lone victory over the year against the Queens Golden Gales? Ottawa would like to make it 2, but they're in tough right now. Clark dribbles the ball, and the Gales have it. What a disaster for the Ottawa Gigis. Clark simply rolling around, looked like he'd go down easily, but he turns it over at the 13-yard line.
shotgun, and actually he's got Darren Joseph, number 20, seemed to be open on the left-hand side. He just doesn't see him. And now he's trying to make something of a bad thing, and he ends up losing the football.
He made a bad thing turn terrible. 1:03 to play.
Victory on the season over these Queens Golden Gales.
Now, if Ottawa wants to get the ball to Chris Banton, they should probably move him up a bit. Now, Banton switches sides, and he may have fooled Galloway, although the ball is short enough, it won't get to him. Loose ball. The first man didn't field it cleanly, but the second one did, and the GGs do bring it down. Boy, that is a very tough way to kick a kickoff, particularly when you're kicking into the wind, when the ball goes up high and almost stops going downfield after about 25 yards. It's almost a free ball.
Oh, it is, and I tell you what, the anxiety level increases for the person that's going to be receiving the ball at the other end the longer it hangs up there, because you know they don't have to give you any yards. As soon as you touch that ball, they can go right through you.
Well, disastrous last possession for the GGs when Steve Clark dropped the ball. Here they stay on the ground. And Michelli finds more room to the outside than he has all game, and Michelli picked up 18 yards.
I tell you, he was a block away from going the whole distance. They had a, he had to receive the block from the wide receiver downfield on Chris McCormick. McCormick saved the day.
Well, if the GGs have any timeouts remaining, they should take one now. Clock is ticking.
Now you can see McCormick is the last guy, and you saw the receiver down there earlier trying to throw a block and miss McCormick. If he gets that block, it's a foot race.
Now let's see if Larry Ring argues here. There was 28 seconds left on the clock. The officials blew the play in. Then they realized that there was an injured Queens player. If I'm Larry Ring, I'd like to see 28 seconds on the clock, not 21.
I'm not sure of your logic, though, because he did not stop the clock, Larry Ring.
He didn't stop the clock, but you can't, the clock shouldn't have been ticking. The officials made a mistake to blow the play in with an injured Queens player there, right?
Yes, until, yeah, they blow the play in until they see that, in fact, he's been injured, and then they have to stop the clock. So it didn't look like Larry Ring was going to be stopping the clock anyway.
Apparently, they are going to add some time to the clock. So
I guess you're right.
Well, you tap dance and try to defend the officials.
All right, give it to me right between the eyes, Michael.
Mike Boone, the injured player for the Gales, he's okay. And, well, they didn't add the time to the clock. They just didn't start the clock. It's still at 21, even though the play's been blown in. Aaron Joseph, not much there. 8 of 4. They need more than that if they're going to get in field goal position.
Joseph, the ball carrier, picks up 3 yards.
17 seconds and counting. Shotgun for Steve Clark as his team trails it by 21. Clark throws and overthrows his intended receiver, Tom Casagrande. 6 seconds to play in the first half. Frustrating first half for the GGs. They have not really moved the ball with any authority at all.
No, offensively, it's been very frustrating. I think defensively, they did some positive things. They stopped a couple of key Queens drives early on.
Three receivers wide to the left. They throw it up, and they try to draw a penalty, which they didn't, and that's it for the first half. No time left, and what started out very well for the Queens Golden Gales with an impressive drive finishes out even better. The Gales have scored 28 points, and they look like a fine football team right now. As they look for first place in the OQ, they lead by 21 at the half at Richardson Stadium. It was 7-0 at one time. It's now 28-7 as we get ready for the second half kickoff. The Queens Golden Gales on the anniversary day have begun celebrating. It's not a victory yet, but 30 minutes from now, football, it likely will be. As the Gales look for first place in the OQ, the Ottawa GGs will kick it off left to right. First half statistics, not surprisingly, favor the Queens Golden Gales. We'll take a look at those in a moment. High kickoff. Kidd fields it at his 35-yard line and then turns on the Jets. Boy, did he show some speed there. And he is still going. Ed Kidd. Nice return. Halftime statistics. Look at the GGs. 2 first downs. 134 yards on the ground. Only 5 through the air. But look at the balance of the Queens Golden Gales. 173 yards on the ground. 171 through the air.
That's just incredible. When you take a look at the other side of the ledger, you're seeing yards rushing. Not bad for Ottawa, but yards passing, non-existent.
I'm trying to figure out how they have 134 yards on the ground and only 2 first downs.
They had that one Darren Joseph.
Here's Elberg. Haven't stopped this play all day, but they do for a change stop it. Elberg did not get to the outside, and they stopped him to maybe a gain of one, but penalty marker came down as well. Illegal block on the part of the Queens Golden Gaels. Likely a hold, and
got a holding. 46. Down repeated. Four.
Jason Moeller.
And where do you think Jason Moeller's from? Again, another guy from Regina, Sheldon Williams High School. He and Paul Kozan and Brad Elberg all from that same area.
Doug Hargraves may have made one trip out west, and it was a fruitful one. He came back with some fine football players. First down and 20, Pendergast to the air, throws, and he's got a man wide open over the middle. Kozan out of the backfield has been a very useful player, one of the Regina connection, and he picked up pretty close to 20 yards. I think he's got it all and a first down.
Well, they really caught Ottawa on the blitz. You can see everybody firing, and no one's picked up the back coming out because they're bringing their linebackers, and no one's to account for them. You see number 13, Chris Johnson, has to try and come across, and some good upfield, open field running by Paul Kozan after he catches the football.
He did pick up 21 yards and a first down for the Gaels, who lead it 28-7. Here's Elberg. Elberg showed great balance, it looked like. Dropped the ball at the end, but not before they had whistled him down.
Great balance and power at the end. I mean, he takes three guys to haul him down here at the end.
But watch at the end. See if he actually has the ball stripped away.
Now he's carrying the ball in the wrong hand right here. Now he should have it in the other hand, and that's what happens.
See if he has the ball
stripped away. The ball.
Yeah, he has had the ball stripped away. He does not have it when he comes down, but the official didn't see it.
Now he has to put that ball in the left hand when he's running left to keep it away from the pursuit coming from the inside.
10-yard average, better than his average of the year? Right on. That's what he's been averaging all season long. Elbert, penalty down. Ottawa may have lined up offside. Pendergast throws, and he threw a knuckler out for Jovetic, and it fell at his feet.
Hey, you know, that's a case for Pendergast right there. He's trying to aim the ball as opposed to throw it. You know, sometimes you see the receiver, you have a lot of time back there to throw the football. You see a legal procedure against Queens. You have a lot of time to throw the football, and you see the receiver open, and you try to hand it to him instead of throwing it.
Have a procedure. Queens, no end. It's declined. Second down.
Doug Hargraves hasn't seen or heard much that he hasn't liked so far. 28-7. We're just underway in the second half. Michael Landsberg along with Jamie Bone and Tim Pendergast amongst others. Second down and 10. Pendergast throws for Jovetic, and Jovetic got all tangled up with Dave Wallace. And there are two penalties down. One might be on Wallace.
And I always like that surprised look on their face, like, me? I didn't do anything.
You know what? From what I could see, I think I'd agree with him.
I don't know. It looked like he was holding him, Michael, from my vantage point, but
are we arguing?
Difference of opinion.
Which, of course, isn't what an argument is, right?
No, that's right. We just viewed it from a different perspective.
There was a second penalty down as well, which was at the line of scrimmage. It was second and 10. The pass went incomplete.
You have a holding.
Well, I think you described it accurately. They got tied up with one another because that's exactly what the call was, holding against Queens and interference against Ottawa. But it benefits the Gaels by 5 yards.
Not only does it benefit the Gaels by 5 yards, but it also gives them another second down opportunity. They would have been forced to kick it away, but instead it's second down and 5. They lead by 21. Pendergast waits and throws over the middle and dangerously over the head of Paul Beresford. Getting cold, as it is right now, and getting colder. Like to have those reliable field goal kickers. Well, that was the breeze that Jamie Galloway was kicking into, but he kicked that 36-yard field goal about 15 yards deep. this game sold out about 2 weeks ago. It's taken a while for everybody to file in, but now they're here and they're having a great time. Ottawa GG's first and 10 from their 35-yard line. Now that's something we saw at the end of the first half. Michelli has fine speed to get to the outside.
Yes, deceiving speed as well. I don't think that anybody thought that he was going to be able to get around the corner there, but they're trying to run counter here and they're pulling Dave Barban and Dave Bulmer, number 63 and 65, from the backside. It looks like he's trapped here, but now he gets around the corner. He shows some fine acceleration. And Joel Dagnoni has to haul him down.
They seem to have the backs to perhaps have a more successful offense than they have with Michelli and Joseph. The problem has been passing game, only 5 yards through the air. And it's not that they've been running on every down either. Here's Joseph. And Joseph brought down very quickly from down low. Number 65, Eric Dell. Second down and 8. As I said, it's very tough to expect much offense when you virtually can't complete a pass, which has been the story so far for the Ottawa GGs. Just 5 yards through the air. Brett Wilson wide to the right. That's where they're throwing. Wilson hooks the pattern up short and comes up just a little bit short of a first down. McCormick moved up and prevented him from making the first down. But he's perhaps a half yard away from the first down marker. I'm sure they'll go for it.
Well, they say the receiver has to know where the marker is, and it was actually a pretty good job by Chris McCormick to come up. He took quite a shot. But as you said, Michael, he's going to be just a little bit short of that first down.
That was a nice pass by Clark.
It was. He really had something on it. He threw it out there with some authority.
And what would you say the temperature is right now?
I would say 2 or 3 Celsius. How about you?
I would say when we started, it may have been about 10. And I'd agree with that. Probably 2 or 3
Celsius.
Yeah,
it's getting colder. Yeah. The rain has stopped.
Meteorologist Jamie Bowman.
Yes, and all quarterbacks have to be good weathermen. You're always wondering what the weather's going to be like on Saturdays.
inside his 10, drops the ball, the GGs have got it. Casagrande looked up and he said, whoa, what's that, the ball? And that's exactly what it was. He looked as surprised as anyone. 11-yard line where the GGs will begin. And a reminder to stay tuned immediately following the game for the TSN Turning Point could be this one. And it's brought to you by Apple Auto Glass.
Tom Casagrande is going to be the man on the spot here, as you see. Say no more. He fumbles the football right here at strip, and it comes almost right into his hand. He did a nice job of fielding and holding on.
Well, he is a receiver, so even though he hasn't had any passes thrown his way, he got the chance at Casagrande. 16-yard line, field of the ball, and that's where the GGs have it. And while it might be stretching it to say that that could be the turning point of the game, clearly if this game's going to turn, it's got to happen right now. Steve Clark's got to find a way to get them in the end zone. The pitch to Darren Joseph, and Joseph loses four on the play. He caught the pitch and almost immediately was hit.
Well, there's obviously, there has been a mistake there in the offensive line. He had no one out there in front of him. And you can see that it is coming in free. Then he has to try and step inside from Mark Morrison, number 28.
Well, he beat Morrison once, and then because there was somebody else there, Morrison had a second opportunity and brought him down. Loss of four. Second and 14. Needs to get to the six for a first down. Clark throws, and he has a receiver, but the receiver is well short of the first down. First reception of the game for Andrew Grigg. I think if you're Larry Ray, you basically have to go for it here.
Oh, yeah. A field goal doesn't do you anything. Now, you know you can probably kick that through. It's not going to help you at all. You have to get some confidence here and try and start running your offense and getting things done and working on that red zone offense when you're inside of the 20. And
red zone offense?
That's right. Inside of the 20 of the opposing team. They call it red zone. And, you know, it's a lot more difficult than you think to try and score because things get a lot tighter in there. You don't have as much room to operate. And the mental psychology of your game changes.
Third down, got to make it to the six-yard line. First thing you got to do is field the snap. He's going to run. And he should drop the ball or flip it to someone because you could tell he wasn't going to make it for the first down. I thought he tried a lateral or something.
I think he was looking to lateral it, but I think maybe he looked at the people he was going to lateral it to and their offensive linemen, and they were going to do a much better job than he was doing.
He has
snaps
had trouble.
A little bit low here. He picks it off the ground. Now, he's looking to run right here. I think he can step up and try and find somebody, but because now if he starts to run, it's very difficult for you to readjust and try to find an open receiver. And I think you were right. It looked as if at one time he was going to pitch it over to Mike McDougal, the offensive guard, number 53. But
I just meant at the end there, you may as well try something because you're coming up short of the first down. Gales have the ball, 13-yard line. Elberg on the carry. Not much running room there. Picked up three. It'll be second and seven. 7:18 to play in quarter number three. The Gales out in front by a score of 31-7. All kinds of generations of Queens. Some from way back and some from way in the future. Over the middle it goes, and a very nice pass. It's incomplete, but Pendergast threw it perfectly. Just a very good coverage, stripping the ball. It was number 41 who made the key defensive play, Eric Lehman. Pendergast seems to be very comfortable throwing the soft pass. He very often chooses just the right trajectory.
Yeah, he's very experienced, Michael, and that's one of the things with a quarterback that makes it. They talk about being a thrower or a passer. Pendergast is a passer. A thrower is a guy who can just throw the ball really hard all over the field, but he doesn't have any touch and he doesn't have any real technical skills of throwing the ball really easily into soft zones and those kind of things and over defenders' heads.
Galloway's kick. This should be interesting. Banton, well, he won't get a chance to field it. Too bad. The Gales have done a pretty good job of staying away from Chris Banton the one time that he's had the... I'm glad you said that. Important game for the Acadia Axemen. They face St. Evex at the half. They lead it by a score of 12-3. We know that St. Mary's will finish first. It's a battle between Mount Allison and Acadia for second. Meanwhile, the U of T Blues, and this is a very important game over McMaster. We'll talk about the importance of that in a second. Joseph drops the ball. The Gales have got a free shot at it, and McCormick picks it up. Yeah, I know what you're saying. Joseph is a very talented running back. He exploded through the hole, but he dropped the ball.
McCormick.
problem at all this year. It is holding on to the ball. He has four fumbles, a very nice move to cut it back inside, and he just gets it popped out.
He runs extremely hard, and he does have that quickness to explode through the hole, but as you say, that's five fumbles this year in six football games. That's too much.
Somebody getting ready for Halloween? I hope.
Now, perhaps it's me, but have you ever cleaned out a pumpkin? They don't smell real good. I cannot imagine putting a pumpkin over my head. Elberg on the halfback option. Banton knocks it away. Is he ever athletic? Banton went up high and made a great play.
And he did. He made a nice recovery as well because he was beaten initially, and then he got back into the play and came up and made a nice one-handed tip-off. You see how there's separation there between Banton and St. Amour. And Banton gets back, uses that leaping ability of his, and knocks the ball away.
We were talking about that U of T McMaster score. McMaster still has a shot at fourth place in the OUAA, but they'd have to beat the Blues today.
And then they would have to beat York next week, so they would have the easier contest. That's right. Whoever wins that game today will probably be the fourth playoff team in the OUAA.
Pendergast throws. He's got Beresford and right at the first down marker. Now, the other thing, of course, was the guy with the pumpkin over his head. Although it is cold today.
Well, Beresford playing in the slot back position. This is a sign of a good receiver knows where he is on the field. He takes it down to make sure that if he has to work back to the football, that he's going to get the first down. Good heads-up play by Paul Beresford.
Who has never played the slot back position before, so he looked very comfortable there, getting exactly the 10 yards required. Kozan up the middle. And Kozan very close to sliding through and going all the way. He has been dynamite every time he's touched the ball today.
Well, they give that option look with the quarterback and the fullback. And, I mean, just straight ahead. He keeps his legs pumping high, nice and high, keeps them going.
Kozan, 2-yard carry today, a 35-yard carry, a 4-yard carry, and a 17-yard carry, along with a 5-yard touchdown reception. Here's St. Amour, and St. Amour crosses midfield and picks up 6. It'll be 2nd down and 4. You're watching the CIAU on TSN. I'm Michael Landsberg along with Jamie Bone, and we are from Richardson Stadium in Kingston today as they celebrate the 150th anniversary of this fine institution. The past 16 years, they have been guided as a football team by Doug Hargraves, who replaced the legendary Frank Tindall, and I think whoever replaces Doug Hargraves will be said to be replacing the legendary Doug Hargraves. Elberg, straight ahead. You know, think of Hargraves' position back in the 70s when he took over this job and replaced Frank Tindall. Late flag on the play. We were talking before the game, and twice he quoted Frank Tindall.
Well, I think he relieved a lot of that pressure when they won the Vanier Cup in 1978. Against the UBC Thunderbirds, score 16-3.
Were you playing that year?
Objectionable conduct, number one. Got a 10-yard penalty and a loss of down, third down.
So the Gales will kick it away. Now tell me what you were doing in 1978.
I think I was sitting in the stands in varsity, and I was freezing, and I was looking at Queens moving the ball up and down the field. And
here's Elberg at the end of the play. Little kick on Chris Banton.
So basically, Michael, I was freezing in the stands watching Queens win a national championship.
Now, who did you lose to in the...
We lost to Laurier that year, and then Laurier lost to UBC, and then UBC lost to Queens, so we were way, way down there on the total pole that
year. And it's a short kick that goes out of bounds. It'll be at about the 50-yard line. So the Ottawa Gigis will have the ball, and they'll have good field position, and that's about all they'll have. 3:33 to play. They trail it by 24. Assume the guy with the rainbow head is probably a latter-day student as opposed to someone from the past. Bart Simpson, you may not know this, the whole Simpson family actually attended Queen's University. You weren't aware of that, were you?
No, I wasn't aware of that.
I believe the Simpsons were here. I think it was the 70s. Clark throws, and he throws over the head of Andrew Grigg, way over his head, and incomplete. 2nd down and 10. Didn't you play against one of the Simpsons?
Yeah, I'm not sure which guy it was. I wasn't sure if it was a guy with a flat head and all the little bumps on top of it or it was somebody else. But
it's hard to tell with a helmet on.
I'll tell you what, it was very difficult. His helmet, he didn't have much of a chin, so he had a hard time putting the chin strap on.
Second down and 10 for the Ottawa GGs. Having all kinds of trouble through the air, 15 yards cumulative through the air. Here they get 8. Unfortunately, they need a 10, and they come up short of the first down, but wouldn't be surprised if Larry Ring goes for it. This is a very important game for the GGs as well. They're thinking fourth place in the OQ.
Now they're just trying to clear out. They drop the receiver in underneath, and that's Andrew Grigg. You can see how slippery the field still is. Andrew Grigg slid about 5 or 6 yards after he was down.
The field may be slippery, but it has stood up rather well. There really aren't any patches that have been dug up by the players.
No, it looks like they take very good care of it as well, Michael. It's an excellent field.
Now the test after the game will be taking good care of it. Third down and through the hole. There wasn't much there, but Thomas was able to slide through and pick up a first down. Excuse me, Darren Joseph on the carry. You know, I was talking about after the game. I remember the game we did 2 years ago. We were interviewing player of the game. May have been Paul Beresford. Was it Beresford?
Yes, it was.
And he got swarmed by, I would say, 1,000 fans. And I said to him, I said, well, I guess we better end the interview. And he said, no, it's okay, we're okay. As he kind of moved through the crowd. First and 10, Ottawa GGs. Throw to Grigg, and he one hops it. One official says yes, the other says no. And the final verdict? Nay. Now this is a very big game for the Queens Golden Gaels. But this is a big game for both teams. Bishop's Gators, Concordia Stingers. In the third quarter, it's Bishop's by 5. Now, Bishop's last week played McGill to a tie. So if Bishop's were to win this one, and Ottawa were to give way to Queens in this one, Queens would win. That means the Gaels would be 1 point up on the Gators as they meet next week in Lennoxville, Quebec. On TSN, we're happy to say. Screen pass in. The ball wisely dropped by Michelli, who never made a great effort at it. I think that's a smart play. He probably would have ended up losing about 15 yards.
Well, he wasn't sure whether or not that was a lateral, you see. What happened is that the ball went off his fingertips, and he thought, gosh, I better be safe than sorry. So he goes after the ball. But you see, the thing is, when you're throwing it to a back, he's swinging out of the backfield, you want the back to be moving up the field, not laterally. And this is the problem, he's moving laterally, and so now he thinks, oh, maybe it's an onside pass, and so he runs after it to make sure, but it was ruled incomplete.
Good call, and it's third down and 10, and Ottawa will kick it away with 1:24 to play in quarter number 3. Nice kick by Hamilton, a boomer inside the 15-yard line. Mark Morrison, 7 on the return, out to the 25-yard line. That's where the Queens Golden Gaels will begin. So next week, we're happy to say that we will be in Lennoxville for Quebec for what looks right now like it could be for the OQ title. Stay with us. We'll return to Kingston right after this. Back to Richardson Stadium, Michael Landsberg along with Jamie Bone. The Queens Golden Gaels in a game that they have to win to really continue to have a shot at first place, lead the Ottawa GGs by a score of... Gators have a fairly well-balanced team as well. They have a good runner in Chris Wilson, Silvio Martel, a veteran quarterback, Pat Gregory, a good receiver, and a good defense. Hellberg straight up the middle. Gain of 6, it'll be second down and 4. And of course, there's Concordia as well. Can't count them out yet, although a loss to Bishop's would certainly hurt their chances at first place in the OQ. Elberg actually picked up close to 8. Second down and about 2.5 yards to go. Here's Elberg again, and Elberg this time short of the first down, brought down very quickly. One of the first times today that the GGs have actually held Elberg short of the first down. 17 seconds to play in the third quarter.
kick it away.
We'll be interested to see if they actually change quarterbacks and go with Othin.
Well, he has been their quarterback the last few weeks and has actually played quite well for them. And it's a tough situation to come in. A little bit different style quarterback than Tim Pendergast. He's more of a scrambling type of quarterback.
Galloway fumbles the snap a bit and kicks it. Chris Banton. This should be fun to watch. 47-yard line. Looks for a hole and then doesn't end up finding one. But he did draw the no yards penalty as he fielded it cleanly. You know, he may not be quite that small, but when I watch Chris Banton, I see some similarities to the pinball.
Yeah, he's very quick that same way. And the other thing I like about Chris Banton is that, and what you just alluded to, he always tries to field the ball. He never allows the ball to drop in front of him if he can help it. He always attacks it. He's aggressive. You can see him looking at all the paint all over him, and he's...
Well, the thing about fielding the ball cleanly is there's not much that can happen bad. Yeah, you could fumble the ball, but I'd say 90% of the time, you get a no-yard penalty.
That's right, because the onus is on the kicking team to locate the ball and to make sure that they don't infringe on that 5 yards.
Very tough sometimes to make the tackle because your momentum's taking you downfield, and sometimes you overrun the play, or you're so busy trying to stay out of the 5-yard restraining area that you don't make the tackle. Clark throws down the sidelines for Greg, and what a beautiful pass! Oh, yeah, that's the pass of the game. Greg was perfectly covered, but somehow Clark laid it out for him.
And this is a nice pass. I mean, he's going to Greg all the way. Give a little pump, fake out and up, and a nice job here because watch Greg at the last moment he extends himself. At the last moment, if he extends out a yard or two back, he's going to drop that football because it's going to slow him down.
Pass interference. Queens, it's declined. First down. End of the quarter.
That was a wonderful pass by Steve Clark. The coverage was letter perfect, but Andrew Greig, at the last second, made the move for the ball, and the Ottawa GGs have a big play at the end of three quarters.
Andrew Greig coming up with the biggest catch of the day, and what a catch it was. He just sticks his hand out and stabs at the football at the last possible moment. There's an interference call on that, but they're going to wave that one off. That would only have been a 15-yard penalty, so they're going to take the catch.
See, the key for Greig on that play was, as you acknowledged, he didn't run with his arms out. He only put them out at the last second, and that really slows you down.
That's
right. You run with your arms out, and he needed every bit of speed there to get to the ball. So the GGs have it, first down and goal from the 6-yard line, and here is Darren Joseph for the touchdown. Made it look easy, and the GGs are on the board now offensively.
And a nice block out front by Richard Bujold, who is the third running back in their scheme. They stick him in there. We see him coming over to give Darren Joseph a little slap. You're going to see number 30 here. They'll let your screen make a nice block right there. Boom. And then Joseph can run outside.
Don't have to give him much room. Just that little bit of a block, even though it wasn't devastating, just enough for Joseph to get to the outside. And as they say, give the GGs their first offensive points. The other 7 came on a Chris Banton punt return. And this is actually 6, and they're going to try to make it 8. 2-point conversion attempt. Fake the ball to Joseph. Clark throws in the end zone and overthrows Andrew Greig. Good coverage, very well covered by James Patterson.
Say about the crowd here at Queens, and we said this a couple of years ago, the score was 31-7, it's in the fourth quarter, and no one has left, and actually people are still coming into this stadium. They stay right until the end, no matter what the score is, and that's really nice to see.
Now, am I seeing so much purple here?
I think we tried to talk about this a couple of years ago. I think it was the engineers here, from what I understand, got a deal on some purple ink. I guess they were using it for orientation. One of the printing companies or ink companies around Kingston was going out of business, and they said, listen, we have barrels and vats full of this stuff. We'll give it to you. So they decided to take it, and that's part of their tradition.
So perhaps in our opening when we showed footage from 100 years ago at Queen's University, since it was black and white, we really couldn't detect the purple, but there was purple there. Are you telling me that?
No, I think it's just a recent phenomenon.
Oh, okay.
I think probably in the last 4 or 5 years.
Rick Melnick's kickoff. St. Amour at his 25-yard line, and St. Amour to the 40-yard line, and that's where Queens will begin. Should the need be there, considering the way history unfolded, it makes those comments even more significant as I walk the line very tightly there. Two-play scoring drive for the Ottawa Gigi's, 45 yards. And there's Beresford breaking back to the ball in front of Chris Johnson, and Beresford, very comfortable running the ball, picked up 9. It'll be second down and 1.
I'm a little surprised that Tim Pendergast is still in the football game, but I guess with the score of 31-13, Doug Hargraves does not want to send any message to anybody on his football team that this game is done, over, it's won, because there's still a lot of time left, and you don't want to give Ottawa anything at this point. I'm sure that if they score another one here, I think you'll see Steve Olkin in the football game.
Pendergast on second down in less than a yard, picks up more than a yard, and it's first down for the Gales. 13:40 to play. They began football here in 1882.
They've won the Grey Cup, the Queen's Golden Gales, 1922, 23, and 1924. The last university team to win the Grey Cup. And they won two Vanier Cups. They've been in three. They won in 1968 over Wolfe and Laurier. 1978, we talked about earlier, UBC, and then they lost to Calgary in 1983.
Alberg on the carry, and perhaps his shortest gain of the day. It's only a 1, if that. Second down and 9. They've got a shot at making it to the Vanier Cup November the 30th, which you'll see on TSN. Certainly they'd be in that group of a handful of teams that would have a good chance. Quick throw, and is that pass interference? Yes, it is. Dave Wallace over the top, and Wallace, I think his celebration will end right here. I don't think there's any question that he interfered.
No, and I don't think he would have intercepted the ball unless he had have interfered as well, because he really pushed the receiver out of the way and went right over top of him to make the catch.
Now, if he...
disbelief. All defensive backs do that, regardless of what league you're in. It's always, they have that innocent look on their face. Who, me? You can see he's all over Steven Jovetic.
I guess if he could speak, Wallace would say, hey, I'm entitled to the ball too. Pendergast throws quickly. He's got Alberg over the middle. He threw it perfectly. 39 yards. What a great pass by Pendergast.
What a great catch. A tough over-the-shoulder catch by Brad Alberg.
Even tougher when you consider he's a running back and would very seldom get the chance to make this catch.
Well, right over the middle, you can see Steve Glenn, the linebacker, is trying to cover him. They have no safety in there. And a great catch. You're not going to catch him when he gets going, that 4.5 40 speed.
It seems as though the game plan coming in was match up Elberg with a linebacker, and that's what they've done all through the game, never with more success than there.
And it's funny how they set it up earlier. They were running him outside, more to the outside, and then in the second half, we've seen them running it inside quite a bit more.
Nice pass. I guess he threw it letter perfectly. Just lay it out and let him use his 4.5 speed, and he needed all of that 4.5 speed to get there. It's Queens by 25.
Frank Tindall, the legendary coach of the Queens Golden Gales, back here enjoying this homecoming. 150th birthday at Queens University. And his team's doing him proud today.
Never would have given that smile when he was coaching, would you?
Probably not.
They weren't one till they were one. Galloway kicks it away. Chris Banton. He'll have some room to operate, and let's see what he can do with it. He went 93 yards before. And Banton this time goes about 40. Took a real shot at the end, but bounces right back up. He is a terrific player to watch. Perhaps as entertaining as any across the land.
And, you know, you look at Chris Banton's stats. He's the leader of kickoff returns in the OQIFC. Now, that sometimes is not a good stat to have, and there's that fantastic haircut, because that implies that you're receiving the ball a lot. But, in fact, in Banton's case here, you can tell he's quite an athlete. I mean, he's accumulating yards because of spectacular returns, not because of the number of returns that he's had.
Took a great shot at the end, but bounced right back up. Greg, nice catch that time. The ball was thrown behind him. Greg picked up five. And then it's ridden down to the ground, but he showed you his ability to adjust to the ball.
And that was a nice catch because he got his hips back and shoulders back towards the quarterback. He didn't try to stick out one hand. He just made sure that he got around and squared himself up and made the catch in his hands.
Greg picked up six. It's second down and four. 11:40 to play in the football game. Queens Golden Gales well out in front, 38-13. Here comes the blitz from Queens, and Ottawa throws it quickly, and it's incomplete. Intended again for Andrew Grigg. Made the right play there. He threw on just a three-step drop, but incomplete. Scoring drive for the Gales looked like this. Four plays, two on the ground, two through the air. They've been almost perfectly balanced all through the day. Final 39 yards on a wonderful pass and catch. Tim Pendergast to Brad Elberg. And now we expect to see a change in quarterback. Likely Steve Hofen, who for a time was the scheduled starter today.
Catch here. It comes back to the ball. eyes on it. He gets his shoulders turned right upfield.
His hands have obviously gotten a little softer since the first play of the game when he dropped a Tim Pendergast pass and it went for an interception. Pendergast throws for Jovetic. Jovetic with a touchdown. Fending the defender, Dave Wallace, off with his left hand. He made the catch with the right.
Now, those two guys were high school teammates, Steve Othen and Kyle Wantzel, at Sudbury. Hooking up here for his first completion of the day.
Elbert, huge hole up the middle. Brad Elbert, inside the 10, down to the 6-yard line. He's got the speed, but he can also move the pile as he did there at the end of the play.
And you know, he has two guys on him at about the 14, 13-yard line, and he drags them down 5 or 6 yards. Very powerful running back. Just run trap, or they're trying to run the trap, but just fold around the guard, and it just becomes wide open. Back inside, and he cuts it inside. Nice block.
They make contact at the 15-yard line. Takes it down to the 6. He is having a great day. Close to 200 yards. Zeroing in on it. Othen throws, and he's got a man at the 1-yard line. Is that Wanzel again?
That's Wanzel again. Kyle Wanzel, his father was a quarterback at the University of Alberta. Back in 1967-70s, we take a look at Steve Othen. Nice pass outside and a nice catch by Kyle Wanzel down to the 1-yard line.
It's about as long a 5-yard pass as you can throw.
Yeah, you really have to be able to throw it far in Canadian football from sideline to sideline. It's a long distance.
1-yard line, second down and goal. And the first carry of the game was that number 35, Don Rorwick. Or was it Kelly Behrens, number 25?
Don Rorwick.
I think it was Rorwick, and Rorwick comes up short. Third down.
Pretty good defensive serves by the Ottawa Gigi's, and a good hit there by Eric Lehman, number 41, coming in from his inside linebacker spot, shot the gap and met Don Rorwick in the backfield.
Nice one-on-one tackle. Steve Glenn is hurt. So, Queens will improve to 5-1 and be in very good position to take first place in the OQ. But to do that, they'll have to beat the Bishop's Gators. 3 o'clock Eastern time, Lennoxville, Quebec. Queens Golden Gales versus the Bishop's Gators.
Now, given that Bishop's beat Concordia today, the importance of this game for first place throughout the playoffs is that the first place team that has hosted the Dunsmore Cup Final, which is the OQ IFC Championship, the last couple of years has won it. So home field advantage is big in the OQIFC. Last year, Queens went down to Bishop's. Bishop's won the Dunsmore Cup. The year before, it was Ottawa here at Richardson Stadium in Kingston. Queens won it. So home field advantage is very, very important.
Now, you said that Bishop's had beaten Concordia?
I said if they beat Concordia today, it looms big.
Okay, yes. I thought you'd said that it was a final. Third down and goal to go from the 1-yard line. The Queens Golden Gales will win this game. The question is by how much? And the answer right now is
a lot.
By 6 more.
Yes.
Othen on the quarterback keeper. He's been very impressive on this drive. 6:03 to play. 51-13 now. The Gales lead the Ottawa Gigi's.
Well, the good serves by the guys up front, and it's a little high, but they have enough serves that he can just kind of fall over the goal line for the 6 points. He's got some big folks up there in front of him. He's got a big offensive line, 280, 275. As the fans continue to sing.
And dance and sway. Might be the best shot of the day right there.
Simpsons back here at homecoming.
I have to tell you, I find it difficult to say much more. I never watched the show, so of course, even if I did, I probably wouldn't.
I wanted to know why Homer had those towels coming out of his ears.
You know, that one shot there might do a better job of recruiting than Doug Hargreaves could ever hope to do, no matter how much he thought.
Sure.
Here, what does that say? I mean, it's a Saturday afternoon, and just a whole bunch of kids are having a great time.
Yeah, it's fun to play in front of a lot of people, and they really get pumped up, and homecoming is a big event all across Canada, all the Canadian universities. Biggest game of the year.
Kick away from Banton this time. That's Wilson, Brett Wilson, and he's out over the 35 to the 37-yard line, and that's where the Gigi's will begin. Let's see if they make any change at quarterback. Steve Clark has gone all the way, and Clark will go no more. Richard Dufour sprints onto the field. Number five, there he is. He'll have, well, at least this one opportunity, and likely one or two more with 5:55 to play to show his coach Larry Ring what he can do. First and 10, 37-yard line. And it's incomplete. It's a pretty tough way to have to come in, running full speed for your life to try to throw that pass.
Yeah, it's a real tough pass because he couldn't get upfield. He couldn't get any of his momentum upfield because Peter Hagerman came in from his inside halfback position, put some pressure on him, did not allow him to get outside. Take a look at the back of Richard Dufour. The very strong SAGEP program in the province of Quebec. A number of fine players going on to CIAU football. He attended Marie Victoria. Native of Quebec City.
Second and 10, 37 for Richard Dufour. Dufour throws. He's got Wilson, but Wilson does not have the first down. Nice job by the cornerback, James Patterson, who's played a good game. The gain is only three, and Ottawa will kick it away again.
Yeah, one of the things that impressed me today about both McCormick and Patterson is how they close so well to the football. Like, instead of playing off passively and waiting for the receiver to catch the ball, they're really off on him right away. So as soon as he does catch it, he can't get turned upfield to make any kind of yardage.
Well, this is a rebuilding year for Larry Ring, his first year as head coach of the Ottawa Gigi's. And I don't think there's any question that there is a job to be done here. At least on this day, they are in a Queens lead. Golden Gales lead it by a score of 52-13. High wobbly kick. Fielded by Morrison on the dead run. And there's what fielding it cleanly will do. Morrison with a fine return down to the 30-yard line.
And I think a spear on top of that.
It's tough to cover it when your momentum's taking you downfield and all of a sudden...
Yeah, and see how he runs, and he just takes it right up the field. I mean, he's not trying to go outside of anybody. He's just trying to, boom, just get that ball, see any opening, and go for it. And right here they call piling on.
Mark Morrison with his best return of the game.
Okotoks.
Moves the ball down to the 10-yard line.
The story from there this week on Sports Desk about a female football player, 14 years of age, playing high school football. Throw over the middle, incomplete. Beresford seemed to be slipping. This one certainly isn't going to slip away from the Gales. 52-13, 4:19 to play. 14-year-old woman playing, or girl, I guess you'd say, playing high school football. Gather, when you played high school football in Halifax, you didn't have any girls on your team.
No, we didn't, Michael. It's really changed quite a bit the last couple of years. You see, some of them are kickers now, and I believe the female you're talking about was playing defensive back.
She was. You saw the story?
Yes, I did.
Rorick drops the ball, and the Ottawa Gigi's have got it. Number 55, Sean Clark, picked it up, and Gigi's, led by their number two quarterback, Richard Dufour, will get one more opportunity. I said Rorick. I'm not sure if it was Rorick or was it number 25. Yes, it was Kelly Behrens. They've made all kinds of substitutions. Kelly Behrens dropped it. 55, Sean Clark picked it up. Now, you're shuffling through your notes all over the place frantically. What are you looking for?
Well, I was looking at Okotoks, and I didn't think that was in Ontario. I thought it was in Alberta. And I saw the font come up, and it said Ontario, I was just trying to look through here in my notes to see whether or not I was incorrect in that or not, but...
I think you are incorrect. I thought it was on the East Coast, actually.
I'm sure we'll get the letters to tell us where it is.
That's Pat Bougeau with his first carry of the game, so Larry Ring, like Doug Hargraves, able to make substitutions now, although under certainly different circumstances. Hargraves knows he's got the win. Craig, I guess, knows he's got the loss. We'll take a look at some other players with 3:26 to play and counting. Gigi's, I guess, would still have a playoff shot. It seems like there are almost two divisions within this one conference. Three fine teams, Bishops, Concordia, and the Queens Golden Gales, and then three struggling teams, McGill. And there is good run support from the defensive back on that side. Number 19, Jeff Yaw on the tackle. And then the other three teams, Ottawa, Carleton, and McGill, struggling for that last playoff spot. Are you looking for an atlas?
No, I don't carry one with me, Michael, but...
How about a globe? Okay, here's how the standings look. With the victory by Queens today, they would improve to 5-1. Let's say they have improved to 5-1. Concordia and Bishops. Now, what have we done there? We haven't awarded any points in that game. Concordia and Bishops are playing right now. Last time we checked, Bishops was leading. Assuming Bishops wins that one, they'd be a point behind Queens, but they would meet next week, so that one, more than likely, would be for first place. Now, Mark Morrison, you were saying you thought that Okotoks was in Alberta?
That's correct.
And it is?
In Alberta.
Did you take geography at Western?
No, I didn't, actually, Michael, but I was just looking at all the players that Queens had from the West Coast, or from the Western Canada, and I noticed all the individuals, Brad Elberg and Paul Kozan from Regina, and also Jason Moeller, and I thought there's another one from out west, and it was Mark Morrison.
Darren Joseph on the carry spins away from the tackle and picks up the first down with 2:48 to play. They'll score 1 point for Jamie Bowen. And score another prediction correct for Jamie Bowen. You improve to 6-0 or 7-0. 7-0, our producer Bruce Perrin says, so you're undefeated. Should be footnoted, of course, by the statement. Yes, you have predicted the favorite every week. Now, I certainly can't blame you for taking the favorite if, in fact, they win. I, on the other hand, went on a limb in the first game and picked Manitoba to beat Saskatchewan, and they almost did. Darren Joseph running hard and running close to a first down with 2:25 to play. See, I was just trying to make food for thought early on, not just pick the favorite all the time.
Yeah, but who decides who's the favorite? Are you just basing it on the top 10?
Well, I think
consensus?
Well, I would you not agree that Queens was the favorite today?
Oh, yes. No, they are, definitely. I think any homecoming team usually is the favorite.
Would you not agree that last week, for instance, U of T was a, you know, perhaps slight 35, 40-point favorite?
I was going to ask you about that, because you did pick York in that football game.
No, I didn't.
I was thinking, well, I know you wanted to go with the underdog. And
I didn't pick York.
I think you tried to change it just before the kickoff. But you know what they say, once the horses are out of the gate.
Yeah, but I didn't see any horses or a gate, so.
Well, kickoff.
Should be a fine matchup next week in Lennoxville, Quebec. Bishop's Gators. Doug Hargraves told us before the game, when I asked him who did he think was the team to beat, he certainly leaned towards the Gators. He was very impressed, actually, with what he saw on our broadcast last time. The Gators hammering the McGill Redmen.
Yeah, he said it scared them. And rightly so. I think Martell in that football game had 250 yards passing in the first quarter. So, then they took him out for a while.
Right. Well, they just have the kind of balance, like I guess the Queens has, but perhaps even more so. They have quarterback Silvio Martell, a veteran, talented, seems to be in total control. They've got a running back in Chris Wilson, and they've got a great receiver in Pat Gregory, along with obviously other players to complement those. But when you have a terrific quarterback, running back, and receiver, you're in pretty good shape. Not sure whether that's dancing to celebrate or to stay warm. Here's Joseph, big hole, and now he shows us his ability to get to the outside, and a good straight arm for Darren Joseph.
Well, I'm sure Larry Ring is very pleased that Darren Joseph is playing for his football team, and I'm sure he hopes that he stays around for a few more years and doesn't leave and go anywhere.
Help me out here with the CIAU rules. A guy plays junior football. When is is he eligible for the draft?
I'm not sure exactly how they work it with the draft. I understand how they work it in the CIAU, that you can, in fact, be drafted after your third year if you're in a three-year program and you request to be put into the draft after your third year, or you'll be drafted out of your fourth year. But junior football does not count as a year of eligibility. They don't draft junior football players.
Richard Bougeau, first carry of the game. So as a junior football player, he was entitled to go as a free agent the training camp of his choice. So he's tried out at a training camp. Now he's playing in the CIAU. Does he have to be drafted in the future after 3 years?
That's actually an interesting question. I'm not sure what the ruling is on that, Michael, but I would assume that since he is, in fact, his graduating year this year playing university football, that he would be eligible for the draft. But again, if he's gone to a pro training camp and he signed a contract with the Ottawa Rough Riders, they might be able to put them on their negotiation list.
Joseph saw that run snuffed out in a hurry. Didn't pick up anything. May have lost a yard. 1:24 to play.
But he continues to run hard, but just no room this time at all. Just didn't get any help. They were trying to run the counter play, pulling the right guard and tackle across.
Matthew Zarouni, 6'3", 216 pounds.
All right, looks good to me.
I like the way he looked over, waited for his cue. You know, the kickers are never the most athletic looking ones. Morrison drops the ball. That's a free ball, and he gets some help from St. Amour, his punt return counterpart. And 56 seconds now to play in the football game. The Queens Golden Gales, with a 52-13 lead, will have the ball inside their 25-yard line. It would seem almost silly for a player to go to the training camp of a professional team and then have to be drafted by someone else.
Yeah, you would think so. So there must be some regulation I'm just not aware of. Because, as I said, the pro team can, in fact, place him, since he's been in their camp, on their negotiation list.
They don't usually do that with Canadians. That's why I'm sort of having a tough time understanding. Kelly Behrens on the carry. Bentley down and behind the play. 51 seconds to play. We'll take you all the way to the Vanier Cup. November the 30th, live on TSN. From the Sky Dome in Toronto. Holdings the call against the Gales. And we'll take you each step of the way, the week or 2 weeks before that. I guess on the 16th, we'll show you the two bowl games. The Atlantic Bowl from Halifax. That'll be the AUAA champion against the Western champion. And then OQ plays Ontario. Take a week off, so they won't coincide with the Grey Cup. Something that I don't think anyone was terribly pleased about last year. And play the Vanier Cup on November the 30th. Seconds to play in homecoming game for the Queens Golden Gales. Not just homecoming, that certainly doesn't do it justice. They have one of those every year, but how often can you celebrate 150 years? Only once.
Now a timeout has been called on the field, and I think it was just to get personnel in there because they didn't have enough. When you start putting in a lot of players that have not been playing in the game, you'll see some clean uniforms in there right now. Sometimes you're not aware that they're supposed to be in there.
Vic Hargraves, one of the few coaches that I've seen recently who doesn't wear a headset. One of the few head coaches. Most do, but he doesn't. It certainly worked well for him today. 50 seconds to play. Here's Kelly Behrens, and Behrens breaking all kinds of tackles, then a face mask brings him down. So he picked up actually about 12 yards, and he'll get more.
Looked like a little more than a face mask. Looked like he tried to grab his head and tear it off. That's what he's calling.
Unnecessary roughness, grabbing a face mask, 51. Automatic first down.
Brady. Nose tackle for the Ottawa GGs.
He was trying to tell the official that he grabbed him by the back of the head.
So the Gales will have a first down as they keep the ball on the ground and try to run up the clock, but with a penalty on every play, and we'll have another one here. It's pretty tough to do. Barron's not able to get to the outside. Bit of run support on that play that the GGs have had for most of the game. Chris Johnson there to prevent him from getting to the corner. Queens move early, but I think that Ottawa will be happy to decline the penalty. I think a lot of us would certainly hope they'll decline it.
Trevor, procedure. Queens, it's declined. Second down.
Victory in six tries, 52-13, and again, we've now watched 60 minutes of football, and it becomes even more difficult to figure out how Ottawa beat Queens. That is a beautiful pass by Oakland, rolling to his left, throwing back across his body, and he threw it perfectly to his high school teammate, Kyle Wanzel.
And you know, the key here is watch how Oakland, even though he sees a defender coming up, he works himself up the field. Now, it was hard to see it in that angle, but in fact, he turned and got his momentum going up the field, so in fact, he could make that kind of throw.
That was a remarkable pass.
And he's having fun out there. You can see the big smile on his face.
Interesting, isn't it, though? He comes into the game, and he throws all three of his passes, I think, to the guy he went to high school with.
That's right. Now, you can tell, though, he's very confident in his ability right now because he had to take over when Tim Pendergast was hurt, came in, won a few football games for them. You can tell he's having a good time out there this afternoon.
Wanzel with three receptions. He's only been in there for about five plays. I guess you get comfortable with a guy when you play in high school with him, and when you get to university, he's the first guy you look for, and in this case, he's found him three times. 18 seconds to play. Third quarter play, U of T Blues lead McMaster 38-17. So a game that many thought would be rather close certainly isn't, and the U of T Blues now look like they have a lock on fourth place. Not looking at the standings right now, but I think it's pretty well assured that they'll finish fourth. And depending on what happens today between Waterloo and Western, they would usually, I think, face that team in the playoffs.
Yeah, I think Lauren King has made a big difference in that U of T football team since he's come back off of the turf toe injury.
Question that they desperately missed him. This should be the final play of the game. Brad counts it down, and that's it. Final play of the football game. The Queens Golden Gales with a very impressive victory on homecoming day. They celebrate 150 years of university life at Queens, and even though the final gun is gone, the celebrations continue.
Game as a head coach of the Golden Gales, shaking Larry Riggs' hand.
Well, while the players leave the field, the fans get on the field.